Vir, welcome to Vega on Air. It's a pleasure to have you with us, and we are very keen to know what were the childhood, your childhood like, and how instances led to you realizing what's your calling.
Well, first of all, Nutan, thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be on the show, and you're my first producer, so it's a great pleasure to be interviewed by
Absolutely.
You and to be in anything you do. My childhood. Well, I had a very complicated childhood in a way, in that I was brought up in Mumbai as it now is, in a reasonably happy family, till about the age of nine, when my mother was diagnosed with suffering from leukemia. It was a misdiagnosis, it wasn't leukemia, it was a kind of anemia. But there were times when the doctors gave her 48 hours, and it was really quite difficult. And my father said the best thing to do was to send me to boarding school, because the thought of seeing my mother dying in front of me was not good for any child. So I went off to Ajmer, to the Mayo College, and I was desperately unhappy. In my first week, I tried to run away from school 3 times. Each time they caught me and they brought me back. But those were totally miserable days. I hated being at boarding school. I hated being away from my mother. And then miraculously, she recovered. And she came, I think I went in January. And by March, they said she was well enough to travel. So she came to see me because they knew I was concerned. When I saw, I mean, she came with nurses and all that. But when I saw that she was well enough to at least talk to me or whatever, it made a huge difference to my life. But I think that experience taught me that even if you're unhappy to begin with, I was very unhappy at school to begin with, if you stick at it and you continue to push at what you are, you'll be okay. And by the end of my time in school, it was probably the best time of my life. I still think back fondly to it. I miss it sometimes. So it's a far cry from the boy who ran away to the boy who, in a sense, didn't want to leave. So lesson number one, never let first reactions decide what's going to happen. Keep pushing, keep doing things. You never know how it'll turn out.
Tell me, you being the youngest editor that any magazine could have in India, you being a person of many talents in the sense that you are equally comfortable with the written word, with television, with many palettes that you have, politics, food, travel, what were the things which sort of honed these skills?
I never studied journalism. And in fact, throughout my career, when I was hiring people, if they had a diploma in journalism, and nowadays everybody who applies to study journalism, I always regarded that as irrelevant. I don't think that helps in journalism. I think that journalism is not something that can be taught. Yes, there are skills in television you can teach. You can teach editing, you can teach directing, you can teach cameras. But at least in written word journalism, I don't think you can learn journalism. I think either you have an aptitude for it or you don't. When I was hiring, I looked for people, not necessarily who wrote well, but people who were interested in the world about them, who were interested in current affairs, who read newspapers. And if it wasn't a hiring for the news pages, it was the future pages, people who had passions, people who followed their passions. I always think that that's how I got into journalism, not because I studied journalism, I did, but because it was a passion, I enjoyed it, I slipped into it, and I did it because, you know, there's that old cliche that the best job is the kind of job where you wake up and do something you enjoy. And that's what journalism was for me. It was something I enjoyed. I much prefer people who do it as a passion.
I had two observations. That you were always at contrary to what the flow was. So if the fad was bashing, if the news headlines were bashing any individual, you would go and observe what were the undercurrents and write a very contrarian kind of a column. Similarly, I noticed that in your talk shows, you will pick up an unlikely person. I remember we were launching a show and Amitabh Bachchan was down and beaten.
So do you remember we went to see Amitabh Bachchan and he was shooting in Delhi and he was locked up in this van and it was late at night and he was like completely down and out. And everyone told us, don't launch with Amitabh Bachchan, he's finished. Nobody is interested. In fact, the head of the channel told me, are you mad? It's suicide. And then when the interview aired, we decided to be contrary and do 2 episodes, not just one. Amitabh Malik, who was then a much feared critic, called me up. And she said, the show was all right, but why did you interview Amitabh Bachchan? He's finished. He might as well be dead. Why are you wasting time on him? So Amitabh Bachchan is the biggest star India's ever known today, and Amitabh Malik is dead, so you know who's right.
And we got the, what a floodgate of emotions. Yeah. People had nostalgia, we got feedback, and we had a great launch to series because Amitabh opened his heart out to you. He told you exactly what he was going through, and you had the best interview ever that you can have. Yeah. Of a star.
But also, if you remember, we captured his vulnerability. Everybody saw him as a star, but they didn't realize that there was a human being there who was vulnerable, who was hurt, who was bewildered, who was confused. He was in the state when he was, what, bankrupt? He had no money. His house had been attached by the bank. His movies were flopping. He was really, maybe Amitabh Malik from the outside was right. He was down and out. But I think you and I saw that you can never write this man out. There's something there,
well, you,
and he will come back.
You were the leader, and I followed
you. You were my producer. It was your decision, much as it was mine.
And what a launch we had.
Go to them.
Even in your columns, I noticed that when you write about people, there is always a view of going for the underdog. Is that something that you do it because you feel it connects in terms of writing, or that's the way you think?
That's the way I think, Nutan. I think that, and you see this if you're watching television these days, it's like a lynch mob. They just go for somebody and everybody abuses them. Nobody puts the other side of the story. The media in full flow is a frightening thing because the individual really never has a chance because people attack people on the basis of the flimsiest of evidence. And if they don't have evidence, they make it up. So I always believe that if you're fair, it doesn't matter whether you agree. When we've interviewed people whose political views I completely disagreed with, your job as a journalist is to get the truth out there, to let people speak and let people see what the truth is. I'm not sure you can ever show the truth in a television interview, but at least you can show the other side.
So to all the journalists who are sitting out there, the budding journalists,
yeah,
and to people who have an inner calling for writing, what would be your three tips?
Okay, I think tip number one is if you don't enjoy this, don't do it. It's not a glamorous job. It doesn't pay very well. The hours are not very nice. So unless you actually enjoy journalism, don't become a journalist. Two, remember that journalism nowadays, at least, is small people being given big power. Never lose sight of the fact that you're a small person. I never ever lost sight of that. But remember, you have big power. You can reach out to many people. You can change people's minds. You can do so many different things. So always use that big power responsibly. If you start believing that you're bigger than the people you interview, that people are tuning in only to watch you, they're not. They're tuning in to watch the guest. Never ever lose sight of that. And always, always be fair. Use that big power responsibly. But you can't afford to be seen as being on anyone's side. You're a journalist. You're on the side of the people.
This school also prides itself for finding the inner star in people. So tell us about how to find your calling. There is a time of uncertainty, for instance, when people don't know what they want to do. How to do that?
I mean, this is advice that's worked for me, and I don't pretend it'll work for everyone. But always do what you enjoy. If you enjoy going to restaurants, you enjoy eating, see if you can turn that into a career. I did. It's one of my careers. If you enjoy talking to people, see if there's a future on television. If you enjoy writing, see if you can make a career out of that. That's not all. I mean, I'm talking about myself, but say if you have a head for figures, if you think you're good at numbers, and I'm terrible, but there are people who, when they see numbers, the numbers talk to them. Think of a career in finance. Never say, I want to do this because I'll make money or I'll do well. You won't. Unless you enjoy what you're doing, you'll never succeed. So work out first what you enjoy and then see if you can make a career out of it.
Thank you so much, Vir, for sharing such wonderful inputs. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you.